Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gifts of Gratitude, The Joyful Adventures of a Life Well Lived by Elizabeth Gaylynn Baker. This book is dedicated to my greatest gift, my family, and to the spirit of love that connects us each to the other. There are so many people to thank in the acknowledgments. Sanjay Berman for giving me this opportunity and believing in my vision, as well as my marvelous editor, Anna Watson, both for her skill and her support. Certainly Santa Fe, a town that has a way of shaping lives, and the spiritual communities at the Santa Fe Center for Spiritual Living and the Santa Fe Harmony Center. Many of my teachers were dead before I ever met them. Many were living but are gone now, and several are still living their lives with a wisdom and a wit that awes me. Some are even subjects of stories in this book. I thank you all, friends and foes alike. I appreciate all that you've taught me. My additional thanks goes to Alan Hale, not only for what he did to bring my family back to me, but for his willingness to share his remembrances of that adventure for me to add to this book. Prologue. Adventures on the Road to Oneness. This is a book about magic. It's not the magic of illusion or magicians or card tricks. This is about a different kind of magic. This is about the magic of life. The book is about my joy in discovering a force so big that it's influenced the course of my life in mysterious and even supernatural ways. Some people call this force God, some call it spirit, some call it the all, some call it the I am. There are probably thousands of other names. What you call it is not important. It's what you do with it or allow it to do with you that counts. In a way, the name The Gifts of Gratitude is a misnomer. I've learned over the years that the only real gift that comes from an attitude of gratitude is grace. This, then, is a collection of stories about the enchanting, unexpected, and sometimes downright dazzling shapes that the gifts of grace can take. Gifts that surprise, delight, inspire, and at times, actually take your breath away. Once upon a time, long ago in Hawaii, I was traveling that twisted road to Hana on the island of Maui. Our car came to an unexpected stop by a roadside attraction. It was simply entitled The Queen's Bath. It wasn't a beach or a path to the ocean. Rather, it was an anomaly, a gorgeous deep crystal chasm sliced into pure rock. There was a sign that explained that this bathtub somehow managed to capture and recirculate clear, fresh water. The entire thing was completely unexpected and unexplainable. The discovery buzzed the thrill through my body. I felt mysteriously inspired. What was a tub of fresh water fit for a queen doing out here in the middle of nowhere? I leapt out of our car, quickly stripped off my clothes, and jumped in. I did so without thinking or asking myself the logical questions. Is it safe? Is the water contaminated? What will happen if another car stops? Nope, no questions. I simply jumped feet first into that pool. Remembering and writing these stories has felt much the same. Daily I've jumped in, inspired and naked before you, and watched these visions of love bubble up. Let me assure you in advance that this book will never answer any really important questions. Questions such as, who are we? What are we doing here on this lovely planet? Or what happens when we die? I'm genuinely sorry, but on those things, I have a few guesses, but no real knowledge. Nope. The reason for this book is simply to suggest that after billions of years, since we don't know what we're doing here, and given that we are obviously stuck here for an undetermined amount of lifetime, bravely awaiting our death, that we have choices in how we spend our time. These are stories, tender stories, funny stories, even dramatic stories about how I decided to spend my time before dying. They trace the squiggly line of my life and reveal how I move from signpost to signpost with only grace guiding me. And if I never do anything more or understand anything more about my life than this, it's enough. And that is very lovely. The Magic Ride Down the Mountainside. The Vietnam War was raging. Gordon, my husband's brother, had returned safely from a year of active combat. To celebrate, he had purchased a shiny 1962 Ford Galaxy convertible, picked up his new girlfriend Joyce, and driven out to visit us. Larry, my husband, Eric, our three-year-old son, and I lived in a charming white frame cracker box house on Karen Way in Tiburon, California. We were thrilled and astonished that Gordon had made it through the Vietnam madness. At a rousing Friday night dinner, we all shared our joy at Gordon's safe return. The ordeal was over. He had made it home without a scratch. There was nothing to do but rejoice. A party was in order. Gordon had visited us before he left for battle the year before. At the time, he could hardly hide his fear. To soothe frayed nerves, the brothers had gone for a leisurely afternoon drive, first to the top of the hill in Mill Valley, then down the Highway 1 to Stinson Beach, then back along the curved mountain road to home. At his welcome home dinner, Gordon shared how the memory of the drive had been the good luck charm that he had clung to in the heat of battle. He asked if we could make that drive again, this time in his shiny new wheels. Saturday sunrise found everyone in great spirits, and shortly before noon we were off. We followed the same road to the crest of the hill in Mill Valley, and then, top down, wind in our hair, Gordon drove us down Highway 1 to Stinson Beach. How could life be any better? Highway 1 is a rather treacherous two-lane mountain road with a view that dazzles in the early afternoon sun. It's barely more than a lane in spots, but the breathtaking beauty of the mountain masks any real danger. The shoddily paved highway has dry and crumbling shoulders that makes it tough to navigate, but having driven it hundreds of times, we were used to it. It had been a long winter, and when we reached Stinson Beach, we piled out of the convertible, eager to explore. Gordon and Joyce immediately walked hand in hand for a romantic stroll. Eric was eager to play. Squealing, he ran to catch his father, and I backed away to let them romp. It was then that I took a moment to look around and absorb the day. Spring had finally come on this first day of March. The sun was excruciatingly bright, and when Larry grabbed Eric and began to twirl him around and around in an airplane hole, they were only a black silhouetted blur, even though they were right in front of me. Eric's tingling laugh commingled with the repetitive sound of the ocean waves and the shrill cries of seagulls looking for their dinner. The spicy sharpness of salt water combined with the stink of rotting seaweed. In that moment, an unexpected, enchanted envelope engulfed me, and I experienced an epiphany. Swept away on a deep wave of gratitude for a whole wad of things, my precious son, my husband, Gordon's safe return, the sand, the wind, the ocean, and my life. Tears popped out of my eyes and rolled down my cheeks as I whispered into that quiet bubble, "Dear Lord, if I die today, How I do thank you. I've had it all. Then a sacred split-second moment unraveled. Sounds penetrated. Movement began again. Eric and Larry stopped whirling. Gordon and Joyce reappeared. Life returned to normal. Soon it was time to go. We'd all had a lot of sun, so Gordon put the top up when we piled into the car. With Larry, Eric, and I in the back seat, Gordon driving, and Joyce curled up beside him, we started back up Highway 1. There was absolutely no thought of danger in that late afternoon. Danger was far away in a forgotten war. Our thoughts were on the dinner reservation that Gordon had made for us at the fancy restaurant in the city. So it was all the more shocking when Larry and I suddenly yelled in unison, "Slow down!" Our warning came too late. In the next second, the car missed the next curve in the road and was suddenly off the cliff. My God, we were all about to die. We were 1 second too late to recover from a horrifying mistake. I wonder now if I slammed my eyes closed. Why do I have no visual memory of my child, myself, or any of us floating like space travelers around the back seat of the car? Why weren't we screaming? Yet the only sound I remember was a deafening silence, until a very calm, high-pitched, completely confident voice began to speak inside my head. "Don't be silly. The car did not go off the cliff. If the car was off the cliff, you'd be about to die." And the car was moving in very slow motion now, the hulking bulk of metal with nothing to hold it up began to twist and turn sideways over and over again before it tipped down and tumbled end over end like a leaf suddenly loose from a tree. The prissy, chattering voice was suddenly interrupted by a much deeper voice that was very calm. "Wow, this is the way I died," said that voice. The words were spoken in hushed, excited tones, like someone watching a fascinating science experiment. Had I been taken out of the car to stand on the sidelines and watch with angels? Why did I say died instead of die? Why was I so unaware of the others who were in the car with me, even my own flesh and blood, my baby boy? Then there was an enormous crashing sound. The large piece of steel landed on its side, wedged between a large boulder and a single tree. For the rest of my life, I would call it God's catching mitt, because it would seem that the chances of stopping that car in that way would be almost a miracle. And yet God's catching mitt was the only thing that stopped us from falling twice as far again, all the way down to the beach, where the car would have surely exploded. The sound of my son's voice shrieked, "Mommy, why did you do that?" It was a question I suppose that all children ask their mommies when something goes wrong. It was a question I never answered. "Thank God you're alive," I gasped. "Thank God you're alive," Larry responded. And with that, it was over. The convertible top was shredded like a tent. Larry helped me walk through it upright and then handed Eric out to me. This was in the days before baby seats or seat belts, so it must have been centrifugal force and Larry's protective arms that had kept us pinned inside. That and the life-saving fact that Gordon had decided to put the convertible top up. There are thousands of almost automatic decisions that you make daily. Then there's one that saves your life. A hitchhiker whom we had passed on the road managed to scramble down to the car. It was he who carried Eric and escorted me up to the road. I don't remember his name or his face. For days, we would laugh about him remarking that he had said his Hail Marys in gratitude that we had not picked him up as he watched the car roll off the road. Laugh, in fact, was all I could do. It was exhilarating, an almost uncontrollable laugh of pure joy. When we reached the crest of the hill, people had already gathered on the road. One woman ran forward as I got there. "Your face is gone! Your face is gone!" she yelled. I clearly remember my cheerful reply. "Just give me a Halloween mask or a paper bag to wear. I'm alive." This was before cell phones, so I don't know how they got an ambulance there so quickly. Someone made Eric and me lie down, although frankly I felt like dancing. I wasn't thinking about internal injuries. I was riding a wave of adrenaline that would make it tough to sleep for several days. Gordon and Joyce had both been knocked unconscious. With the hitchhiker's help, Larry carried his brother up that steep hill, and then they returned to carry Joyce up to the road where we were all finally loaded into an ambulance and headed towards Marin General Hospital. I do remember yelling several times at the ambulance driver as he roared around those last remaining mountain curves, "Slow down! What's the rush?" I don't remember arriving at Marin General. I do remember hugging the rather famous plastic surgeon that stitched me up a few minutes after we arrived. A large piece of steel from the frame of the convertible top had etched a dainty but deep cut on my face, precisely on my left frown line, hence all that blood covering my face. While he was sewing me, he shared that if the cut had been an eyelash deeper, I would have died. Imagine that, an eyelash. That surgeon hadn't even been on duty. In a burst of synchronicity, he had simply been there, on his day off, drinking coffee and flirting with the nurses. He immediately responded when the ambulance rolled in, using his considerable skill to sew up my face so that it left the least possible scar. Gordon's convertible had fallen 500 feet. That's the height of a six-story building. How could we have all lived through such a drop? Even more miraculous, after the dust settled, the injuries were minimal. Gordon had a black eye, Joyce had a broken tooth, and I had a small facial cut and a swollen black and blue face. But the bruises were actually from the surgeon's stitches. Only Larry had to spend several days in the hospital. His cheek had been pushed in, and the doctors had to do a minor operation to pop it back into place. It was never a life-threatening injury. That night, I sat by my son as he slept, touching his teeny fingers and arms and legs and toes, marveling that he had survived without a scratch. Of course, life was never the same. It was as though a huge period had been placed at the end of a sentence and new lives had begun. Oddly enough, my marriage to Larry, though it would last several more years and produce another son, was over. And even though we didn't realize it, the flight down the mountain had shown each of us different roads to travel. Gordon married Joyce, and they spent many years together, but their union eventually ended in divorce, which left Gordon free to finally find his true love. Eric and I still call each other when March 1st rolls around, and we laugh now at how glad we are to have had another year. But none of us have ever been able to really explain what happened. Perhaps we all died, and that's what death is. A path continuing on. Or perhaps we jumped ship and new spirits walked in. Who knows what the real answer might be? I've since learned that there are many possible outcomes for every event. Did I influence the outcome with my epiphany at the beach when I traveled beyond normal time and space and from my soul expressed gratitude in advance for the challenge I would face on the ride home? Dear Lord, how I do thank you. If I die today, I've had it all. In gratitude, I surrendered my life to Spirit that day, and Spirit, with a smile, reached a mighty deciding hand across eternity and gave it back to me. It was a gift of gratitude for which I am forever grateful. I Kiss Your Knees. There was a huge crowd of Sunday participants at the Agape Church in Los Angeles that morning. The service was just ending. The children who had been in the church nursery were being brought out to the stage. Their parents would come forward to get them as soon as the choir stopped singing. He was a teeny blonde boy, not much older than 3. Somehow none of the teachers noticed him walking off the stage and wading into the seated crowd. I saw him, saw the terror build in his eyes with his every step forward. He had started down an aisle to find his parents and realized too late that he had no idea where his parents were seated. Our eyes connected and I couldn't look away. He held as tightly to my gaze as he might have to my hand as he kept coming forward. Then he suddenly broke into a grateful smile. He had spotted his parents, whom I didn't know, sitting a couple of rows in front of me. What were the chances of that with at least 500 people in the room? No matter, I was just grateful that it had ended so well. We exchanged a last secret smile as he reached and was greeted by his surprised parents. A few minutes later, the service was over and the attendees were all standing around outside saying goodbye. I saw the child across the courtyard holding his mom's hand. More importantly, he saw me. Urgently, he dropped her hand and headed my way. Not stopping him or fussing at him, his mom quickly followed as he rapidly walked several steps ahead of her to reach me. When he did, he gently lifted my full blue satin skirt with his small hands, and looking all the way up to my face, he simply said, "I kiss your knees," which he promptly did before dropping my skirt and heading back to his mom to go home. Water. I love the woods. Whenever I get to the woods, it feels like I've come home. The quiet silence of the trees hits me at a depth that few other things can touch. But it is the element of water, ponds, lakes, and oceans that have played an electric role in shaping my life. Even though I was born and raised in Fort Worth, Texas, I don't remember seeing a lake until I was 9. That's when I went to Girl Scout camp at Lake Worth. My particular personality pattern was to want to get away from home and then, once away, to experience a terrible bout of homesickness that made me plead to go home again. My problem was that I wanted to go home to a place that didn't exist, a loving home where my dad would still be alive and my mom would be the sweet mother she had been when dad was still there. I yearned to go back to a place that existed only in my mind. Camp was okay. Screened-in cabins with lots of small beds, dormitory style, girls hanging together, giggling, doing all those things that little girls do. But the simple act of hanging out seemed impossible to me. After Dad died, those early years had become a potpourri of frustration and anxiety. I seldom fit anywhere and definitely felt like an outsider at camp. So there I was, wishing I was home, pretending that I didn't care about not fitting in, and glad that there was one consolation, the lake. The counselor had gathered all of us in our swimsuits to play at the edge. I guess my wish to be invisible worked because she didn't notice when I wandered away into the deeper water. I barely noticed either because I was busy watching something. Out on the lake, there was a beautiful sight that I had never seen before. It was a small, white, wooden boat with a white thing hauled high in the air, catching the wind. At that moment, I didn't have a name for it, although I would quickly learn that it was called a sailboat, a boat that depended on the generosity of the wind to whisk it rapidly through the water, had burst through my moping boredom and electrified my heart. Why had it enchanted me so? Was it the magic of the unknown? Had I sailed a schooner in another life? Was it an illustration from some long-forgotten nursery rhyme? Even after all these years, I have no idea. But when it came into view, I heard the siren's song, and something about the gentle way it was gliding through the water, leaning from side to side, touched a visceral chord in me, and my heart lured me on. Without an ounce of caution, I moved towards it. And before I knew it, my body was out of the shallow, sandy water, and I was in water up to my chin. There was nothing to do now but turn back or swim. And swim I did, although before I reached the desired object, it did occur to me that if I couldn't climb aboard it, I would never have the strength to make it back to shore. Never mind, it was too late to worry about that now. The captain at the wheel displayed great surprise when he saw the teeny girl treading water by his vessel. Then mercifully, he smiled and asked the sweetest question imaginable. "Ahoy! Would you like to come aboard?" Gliding over the water with a dashing sailor in a sailboat was my idea at age 9 of a real accomplishment. The sailor, I can almost remember his face, though I've long ago forgotten his name, was enchanted as well. He shared his knowledge of boats with the wide-eyed girl I used to be while we sailed around the lake. Then he escorted me back to where the counselors and the campers were playing. They hadn't even missed me. Imagine my newfound popularity when my friend offered to take all the other Girl Scouts, a few at a time, of course, for a sail around the lake. I graciously stepped off so others could have a turn, basking in my newfound triumph. That is the first time that I remember being able to create something totally unexpectedly out of thin air. Although perhaps I'd done it earlier and just forgotten. And even though I didn't even know the word alchemy at the time, I'd had my first taste of it. I was hooked. Adam and Mother Ocean. We moved to Hawaii when I was pregnant with our second son, and Adam was born there. To my mother's horror, I took him into the ocean for a few minutes when he was only 3 days old. She demanded to know what I was thinking. I can't remember my reasoning, only that it seemed very important to me at the time. One effect it may have had was forming Adam's deep love of the ocean and the creatures in it. This story is about an adventure that Adam and I shared when he was only 9 months old. Our family, Larry, Eric, Adam, and me, was at the beach with friends. It was a stunning sunlit day, and I held Adam in my arms as I waded out to my waist. Suddenly, and without warning, he was knocked loose and swept away by a wave rushing out to sea. It had all happened so fast, there seemed nothing I could do. "The baby's on shore. You never had him. Go on shore right now to check that he's safe," my mind declared. But my mind's denial didn't fool me. Throwing my head back, I bellowed like a water buffalo, shaking my fist at both water and sky. One word came out of my mouth: "No!" A wave never moves in a straight line. That's how it gets its name. However, the wave that snatched Adam simply reached the end of the outgoing movement and immediately turned around and brought him back to my arms in a line so straight that only Spirit's hand could have drawn it so precisely. And Adam laughed as though to say, "Wee, that was fun, Mom, let's do it again." Crying tears of gratitude, I carried him back to shore to fix lunch. You look a lot like Steve Allen. At 14, I made my first television appearance doing a tap dance on a local show in Fort Worth. It was a talent show hosted by an unknown kid named Pat Boone. That was the first time I set eyes on a small red glow that lights up in front of a television camera when the juice is turned on. For me, it was pure magic. And I made a silent vow to follow that camera light wherever it might lead me. By 16, I had a 15-minute spring hairstyles program on Saturdays on a Fort Worth station. I had made an appointment with the manager and banged into his office like gangbusters. Throwing myself across his desk, I begged him to give me a chance on TV. I can't remember how I came up with that plan, but I was thrilled when it worked. Later in New York, when he came to a national station managers convention and took me to dinner, he reminisced about our first meeting and told me how proud he was that the little girl in bobby socks who had begged for a chance had gone on to a career in New York. I told him how that first job had led to meeting a man who looked a lot like Steve Allen. This is that story. Steve Allen had come to Fort Worth to do a remote of his Tonight Show. We were all very excited that he was in town. And more importantly, he was at our station. I was there to do my short Saturday morning show, and by some miracle, Mr. Allen, preparing for his remote presentation, had happened to glance over to a monitor and had seen me. A messenger came hurrying down the hall as I headed for home. Mr. Allen wanted to meet me. "Is this a joke?" I questioned. "No joke. Please come this way," was the reply. My mother and I followed the usher down the hall, and sure enough, there he was, the real Steve Allen. He explained with a smile that he had seen part of my short on-screen appearance, and he thought I was a natural. Did I want to stick around with him and the crew and watch the remote that was taking place? I was blown away. Most of the rest of the day was a blur. We were transported to the actual theater where the show would take place, and I got to watch repeated rehearsals, scene blockings, sound checks, wiring, all those technical things that have to be done before a national television broadcast. From time to time, Mr. Allen would actually ask me for my opinion. I tried hard to keep my head on straight and speak English. The live remote went off without a hitch, and afterwards, we proceeded to the cast and VIP party at a hotel ballroom. I remember the magnificent ice statues, something I had never seen before, and an enormous array of food. Then the fairy tale was over. Mom arrived to drive me home. It was time to say goodbye. When you get to New York, and you will, please come by the show. Perhaps we can find a spot for you, were Steve's parting words. And hey, thanks for hanging with us today. Wow! That was enough encouragement to carry me through the remainder of those strange, dateless, and always misunderstood teenage years. To my amazement, as I kept following that television dream, doors opened, and 3 years later, at 19, and feeling very grown up, I did get to New York. A lot had happened to Steve during those 3 years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.